Okay, guys. You wanna see how a busy day looks like? That was a classic afternoon at the University of Pennsylvania. So, 10 years ago. Sometimes in our location, things look like this as well. All right, so. Thank you for coming back. I think we got the same number of good people. And now we discuss all the equine herpesviruses. You already got an exposure on EHV1 regarding the neurologic form. And now we'll discuss this very important virus, the various form, which are four, as I discussed already. So an overview of the four forms, or the four natural forms of EHV1 infection, or an overview of the four forms of natural EHV1 infection. The virus, classic structure, that was my former garden when I was in Pennsylvania. That was a $1 million horse. And unfortunately had a severe case of EHV1 myelencephalopathy. That's winter in Pennsylvania. Of course, now in Louisiana, the situation is totally different. We don't see this white material anymore. We see it for a few hours and then it's gone, once a year. Okay, a little bit of ultrastructure. Virus characterized by an envelope that make it very weak in the environment. You know, big difference between herpes viruses or picornavirus and parvovirus as an example. Herpes virus, you know, show them a little bit of sunlight, disinfectant, scan, all the others stay in the environment for quite a bit. Very, very easy to disinfect, clean and disinfect after a EHV1 outbreak in a stable, you know, abortion, even with uterine fluids and fluids from an abortion. And if you got an outbreak of parvovirus in dogs, it's pretty complex. The following phase. Tegument, nucleocapsid. There are four forms. EHV1, abortion, which is generally episodic. Rest, there is a vaccination to protect this form. I didn't think I said anything wrong. Respiratory disease, sporadic. EHV4 is much, it's a keen virus instead to develop respiratory disease. Myelencephalopathy, that we discuss extensively, and we just review here very briefly. And then we have EHV4, which is responsible for benign colloidal exanthema, which I saw three times in my career. And then EHV4, causing sporadic abortion. We mentioned the difficulties to grow the virus. You need to use equine fetal cells. Instead, EHV1 is very easy to grow in tissue cultures. Now with PCR, just need PCR, you are good to go as a biological diagnosis. Respiratory disease, as I mentioned, for EHV4. EHV2, mild conjunctivitis. I remember people identifying for us EHV2 in cases that were totally unrelated to significant infections, stress horse, febrile horses. And I remember an episodic of laminitis, a group of horses we never understood fully, where from this horse it was possible to isolate EHV2. I'm not saying EHV2 causes laminitis, but some of these horses were shedding EHV2, most likely stressed, so they reactivated the virus. And then there is this a relatively new entity, probably a 10-year-old entity, which we started observing in the 90s and eventually was characterized by Michigan State University with the help of several institutions, including us, the pulmonary multinodular fibrosis of horses, equine pulmonary multinodular fibrosis, that we see a few slides of, very interesting disease, a gamma herpes virus that causes fibrosis in the lungs with inclusion bodies. Then there is EHV6, also identifies as AHV1, AZ9 herpesvirus 1, then 7 for the 2 and 8 for the 3. These are AZ9 viruses. So a total of 10. Of course, classification may change. This classification that I dated 1 or 2 years ago. That's a great example of coital exanthem. I took this picture in 92 at Newmarket, England, at the Animal Health Trust. Very nice case of inguinal erosion ulceration. Very similar to the genital lesion that we can see in primates, especially in humans, due to human herpes virus 2. The big difference is that this virus is present in the equine population, but shows up very rarely. I can tell you again, 3-4 cases in my career. And this was a particularly interesting case. Human population, the equivalent, which is human herpes virus, genital herpes type 2, I mean, 1 every 5 people in North America has got latent infection. So it's a disease that spread dramatically in the 60s for some dramatic change in behavior of the young human population. And interestingly, as EHV1, we are talking about the human herpes virus 2, can induce natural mortality abortion. You can have abortion in when the virus reactivates in the female, human females in the latest phase of pregnancy. So, and this is EHV5. I took this picture in 1994 at Cornell University, and I bet with my mentor, Professor John King, that this was going to be inflammation, and he bet neoplasia, one of the few times that he lost and I won, and we bet something that I cannot repeat, and he still didn't pay me. So it was a multifocal to coalescing lesion. I thought granulomatous, he thought it was sarcomatous, but eventually was granulomatous looking lesion. And already in a previous case we had in 1993, which was very similar to this one, at the microscope we could observe some inclusion bodies within the modified alveoli with fetalization of the epithelium, macrophages in this alveoli. And then we noted some form that from multifocal to multifocal to coalescing became diffuse. Lymph nodes of the bronchial lymph nodes, very enlarged, so lymphadenopathy with lymphadenomegaly, and histological lots of lymphocytes, plasma cells, macrophages. But these inclusion bodies remain kind of the interesting feature in addition to the pattern of this disease. And at the time we did immunohistochemistry for EHV1, we did it for equine adenovirus, we tried any possible virus isolation, until in Michigan, one of my resident mates at Cornell University, and now associate professor of pathology at Michigan State University, Kurt Williams, that has got a strong interest for respiratory disease, in particular horses, with the help of Dr. Mass, the virologist at Michigan State University, characterized this as an inclusion due to equine herpes virus, equine gamma herpes virus 5. So we realized that the inclusions were pretty much in the middle of these progressively areas of interstitial pneumonia and fibrosis. So we thought that this was significant. And the manuscripts were accepted. You can understand the severe respiratory distress that these horses experience during the progression of the disease. And interestingly, there are some cases of pulmonary fibrosis in humans that are also associated with possibly with herpes viruses. Then, occasionally, we pull out some gamma herpes viruses from adults, but in this case was a fetus, with this giant cell atypical pneumonia. So it's possible that gamma herpes virus is sporadically co-associated with abortion with this kind of unusual pneumonia. I think has been reported in the literature, one case, so we didn't publish this, but I think it's out there. Very rare, couple of cases in my career. Look at the monstrosity of these giant cells. It could be just an incidental finding, not necessarily virus associated, or perhaps it's due to a gamma herpesvirus infection. Plenty of macrophages here. Small giant cells, large giant cells. Again, rare case of abortion associated with these large cells. And we are talking about a service that will see many abortions every season. So keep looking. And then, before we hit the EHVN again, this is a brainstem. This is immunohistochemistry for EHV9, or also gazelle herpesvirus 1, which we describe in a gazelle and characterized inducing encephalitis. And here is the antigen within the nuclei of these neurons. The manuscript on the journal Veterinary Diagnostic Investigation. We start from the clinical side, we characterize all the lesions and the molecular features of the viruses, of the virus. Pathogenesis and description of the four EHV1 forms. So again, four form, conventional respiratory form, mild, pulmonary vascular tropics form, fatal, looks like African horse sickness, but is rare, fortunately. Abortogenic form, which is the most important, and the neurological form we discussed extensively in the other talk, which is equine neuropathology, which has been already recorded. We went through this process using indirect immunohistochemistry. Actually, the first work in 92-93, we were using direct immunohistochemistry, so we had less signal. This was last part of this work has been started by Whitwell and Smith using direct immunohistochemistry. Then we start using indirect, that was revealed to be much better. Studies been done with polyclonal antibodies, emphasizing the virus within the nucleus and cytoplasm, and then following this with a very specific monoclonal antibody produced in Kentucky by Professor Allen, famous virologist, that were able to emphasize the virus mainly to the cytoplasm. And then, occasionally, in cases of viral infection with little expression in the tissues, which is not the case of EHV1, but generally equine viral arthritis, we use polymers. Very useful if you study diseases like West Nile, equine viral arthritis, African horse sickness, blue tongue in general, not necessarily all equine diseases, or in poultry, in avian and chelonian tissues, where you need a particularly clean system to identify a small quantity of virus. If you need protocols, glad to give them to you. So everything starts within the respiratory tract. I still remember a great picture of immunohistochemistry of Catherine Whitwell showing lots of virus within the nasal cavity of infected horses. These are a bit more caudal, that's my case, and it shows how the virus replicates in the pharyngolaryngeal area. Here there are some glands with some crypts in the laryngopharynx. You can see how the virus multiplies in these epithelial cells. This is a feature of the majority of gamma herpes viruses. This could be the replication of BHV1, so bovine swine, they all start the same way. Of course, it's a aerosol play a role. Then the virus from there, after a multiplication in this epithelium and within the Waldeyer lymphoid area, if it is generally EHV4, it stays within the respiratory tract, although sporadically can also induce viremia. EHV1 is very good in via white cells, and here they are. This is the lumen of blood vessel. This is the wall of the blood vessel, which is edematous. These are endothelial cells, and these are macrophages. They are able to, the white cells to infect endothelial cells and probably vice versa. And so you have a systemic replication in white cells and then in endothelial cells. Actually, these endothelial cells has got even a beginning of something that looked like an inclusion, stretching around it. So, and this is a very important pathogenetic moment where the endothelial cells is the gas station, is the station, is the taxi parking lot, and then the white cell is the taxi driver of this infection. Like it's happened in several viral diseases. In EHV1, since there is a lot of virus in the host, that's more visible. And a close up on the macrophage, blood vessel, lumen with red cells, discharge endothelium, another macrophage, and then here a macrophage with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 viral factories. This is, look at the, so it's traveling and it's replicating. And then, these are pictures that I took at the Animal Health Trust in 1992. This is an experimental infection that has a lead investigator, professor now, Ken Smith. I took the picture. He was leading the experiment. And you can see how the aspect of the uterus is reddish, dark, and histologically, we detected a necrotizing endometritis. We also isolated Streptococcus epidemicus from it, but we don't think it was particularly significant. You see the cervix involved, the whole uterus, and that's a viral endometritis. And histologically, still using a direct immunohistochemical technique, here's the detection of the virus within the endothelial cells, and in associated with vasculitis and perivasculitis in lymphocytes and macrophages. And actually, I'm sure Dr. Professor Smith has got his collection some slides of thrombosis, which are not present here. Because thrombosis is not so easy to detect, but was present. Uterine gland here. So you understand how the virus from the respiratory tract through the viremia can reach the uterus and induce hypoxia. At this point, the virus can reach the placenta, but in experimental infections, as described by Smith, Mumford, Whitwell, and others, a rather dramatic virus challenge to the horse experimentally can induce a sudden, some severe changes into the uterus, a sudden allantocorion detachment, and then the mare experimentally, these have not been detected in the natural disease, the mare can expel a virologically negative fetus, which at the time was a blessing for the virologist, because if you got a virologically negative fetus, you know, you need also to work on the mare to get a diagnosis, what was great for the increase of diagnostic submissions. But this has been reproduced only experimentally. Then, if the fetus is not expelled yet, the virus crosses the placenta. And there is not much virus there. And we were lucky here, a Cornell one, fetal natural cases of abortion due to HIV-1, to detect the virus. This is the allantocorium, that is the portion of the stroma. So that's a blood vessel. And there is a macrophages, which is traveling within this venule. And then these endothelial cells. So this is the demonstration of immunohistochemistry of two cells in the placenta. Again, the placenta is the last resource for the diagnostics. If you lose the uterus, got just a placenta from a mare, you can use that placenta for a EHV-1 PCR or virus isolation. Then, after crossing the placenta, the virus reaches the parenchymous organs of the fetus, and that's a very nice pathogenetical moment. The virus from the endothelium of the blood vessels, in this case from the liver, is able to penetrate within the endothelium of some privileged parenchymas, which are going to be lung, liver, lymphoid tissue, in general, including thymus, adrenal gland, in a few other occasional tissues, not much the brain, not much the skin, but the one I mentioned, the 5, 6, which are very important then to collect for your histopathological diagnosis, virological diagnosis, and then it penetrates within the sinusoids and then progressively goes to the hepatocytes. Look at this. Venule, with virus and then going to the cyanocytes, to the hepatocytes. This hepatocyte even has an inclusion body. These are monoclonal that recognize the virus only in the cytoplasm. So you understand how this, with this mechanism, direct, indirect cytopathic effect on, or indirect cytopathic effect, this can create that necrotic foci that sometimes you see, that you often see histologically, and you rarely see macroscopically, grossly. And that's the mechanism of all the abortigenic gamma herpes viruses. There are some variation. Which are the variation? BHV1, the bovine, prefer to induce also a vascular necrosis in the placenta, which EHV1 doesn't. Love the adrenal gland more than EHV1. In dogs, the canine herpes virus 1 will go to the kidney, inducing the pathognomonic lesion, an organ that all the other herpes viruses don't like much. So there will be this minor, major, because we are pathologists, so anything is minor is interesting for us because it's a detail, and we are detail-oriented. So anything, EHV1 is a model for all the possible gamma herpes viruses, including human herpes viruses. When I show the fetal lesions of EHV1 to a human pathologist, if you go to the comparative veterinary and medical comparative pathology meeting that is every 2 years now in Zagreb, the URAC symposium, you show these slides, the histo slides to reproductive pathology of the human field, they say that looks like human herpes virus type 2, the genital herpes. Then he reaches the parenchyma, where it's rather destructive. You're going to find the antigen at the edges of the lesion. You're going to find the inclusions at the edges of this immunohistochemical detection. Look at it here. In the middle, there is necrosis. You don't see much. There are no neutrophils. There are macrophages, lymphocytes, also cariolysis, cariolexis, degeneration. The majority of the equine fetuses that are between 6 to 9, 10 months will have hepatic necrosis. In the latest period of infection, there will be mainly respiratory lesion. There will be a necrotizing bronchiolitis, interstitial pneumonia, but not much virus in other organs. Very interesting. So, young fetus, not too young, well, 6, 8 months, liver lesions mainly and other organs, and around the parturition, mainly pneumonic lesion with a few hepatic foci. And eventually the liver looked like a battlefield with multiple rocket propelled grenade areas of disruption of the tissue. And this could be any other animal fetus with the same infection, with the corresponding herpes virus. And then, now that we know what the virus does, where it goes, you can look at the lesion of the virus. I switch a little bit. Instead of starting from a gross lesion going to the DNA, we start from the viral DNA, we go to see histology and macroscopic changes. The areas of necrosis I mentioned, there are also always this portal area, lymphocytic and histiocytic infiltration, some circulating leukocytes, so don't stop at the necrosis, see the other changes. Remember that some lesions that look, are bacteria but look herpetic, but they have neutrophils, remember, they've got neutrophils. And then, around this area of necrosis, look for inclusions. There are several. They need to be acidophilic, red, pink. There is margination of chromatin and fragmentation. This halo. If you don't have all the features, don't call the inclusion. Be conservative. Okay, how many? 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, any cell. And then, if you're lucky, if the liver lesion is sufficiently severe to induce macroscopic changes, you'll find some of these areas in necrosis. And I don't know what the screen expresses here. They are not white, they are not yellow, they are gray. Yellow, yeah, white would be fibrosis, gray would be bacterial yellowish orange would be bacterial necrosis. Gray is the color of viral necrosis in a fresh equine fetus. And in school, they told us that this is the pathognomonic lesion. You diagnose it grossly, and that's what you need for your diagnostics. In reality, just a small number of equine fetuses show the necrosis. But they all have histologic lesion. And there is a minority of those fetuses, experimentally, that don't even show anything because there was so much psychopathic effect at uterine level that the mare slipped the foal very rapidly. But that's only experimental. So that's a different twist of the disease than what we got from our mentors in school. Remember that you can observe also the virus, especially in fetuses at term, at the thymic level. And where they go to the epithelium of the stroma of the thymus, nucleus and cytoplasm, where they can induce necrosis, apoptosis. Also, they go to macrophages, here with indirect immunohistochemistry, here with direct immunohistochemistry. You see there is less expression here because this technique is not so emphasizing the antigen as this one. So thymus, very important. And what it does to the thymus, the thymus that look like an autolytic thymus. Take a thymus, put it on the window in a sunny day, retrieve it after a couple of hours, it will look like this. In this case, in that case, autolysis, in this case, it's necrosis. Thymic necrosis. Important organ to check. Always cut the thymus, collect thymus for virology and for your histology. And here are the inclusion bodies in the thymus, in the epithelium. Quite a few in this case. That was a fetus at term. Don't forget the spleen. The spleen will be affected by depletion of lymphoid follicles with chiriolysis, chiriorexis, infiltration of macrophages, hyperemia, swollen endothelial cells. A detail on these lymphoid follicles, you see edema, pycnosis, chiriolysis, chiriorexis. The antigen will be present, especially in the early phases. Don't forget that you want to check your adrenal gland, and this is the zona glomerulosa. That's the capsule where you can find some cells with the intranuclear intracytoplasmic virus. And you'll find in these adrenal cells, that's not liver, that's the zona glomerulosa of the adrenal, your inclusion bodies. And remember, in bovine fetuses, this is the target organ, plus the placenta. So same fetus, same organs I mentioned for the equine fetus, but in particular, don't miss the adrenal gland and don't miss doing immunohistochemistry or sending a piece of chorioallantois for virus isolation and PCR, because the BHV1 like those two tissues even more than EHV1. And in this newborn foal, obviously was infected in utero, necrotizing bronchiolitis with several inclusion bodies on the right. And this is the same bronchiolus in serial sections where I performed immunohistochemistry, where you can see that the virus is moderately present within this bronchial epithelium. And when I showed this slide 10 years ago to, more than 10 years ago, to a human pathologist, she said, oh, that's human herpes virus type 2. Perinatal death in humans, same lesions. This fetus survived a little bit longer and developed also secondary bacterial pneumonia 3 days after birth. Lots of virus antigen. This was truly a foal with lots of shedding potential and lots of antigen within the lung, and that's the only EHV1 expressing hepatic focus in that case. So lung, very good specimen for these folds at term. Thymus, moderately. Liver, not so good. Of course, PCR should be positive, but you can also have fold negative. So the role of the pathologist paramount to get a diagnosis. The pathologist is very important for all the diseases I mentioned to you so far. The only disease in which the pathology has got a weak spot in the diagnosis of the cause. It's equine viral enteritis, I will see. In equine viral enteritis, you can have fetuses that are positive with PCR, but you don't see many lesions. That's a little bit of a difficult zone for us. But EHV1, we are on top. And here is the respiratory epithelium with multiple inclusions. Almost any bronchial cell has it. Even here, some alveolar cells. And in this case, it is the case of the fetus that survived longer, there are also syncytia. So a virus that loves inclusion, syncytia. So a virus that loves to create syncytia in vitro, as it EH1 is, forms also something in vivo. There is a wonderful manuscript about EH1 myelin encephalopathy in the 70s or early 80s of an American Journal of Veterinary Research, Experimental Infection. So they were able to reproduce the disease, the myelin encephalopathy form, plus they had syncytia within the blood vessels in the CNS. Never, I saw it once in a natural case. Wonderful manuscript. How the fetus looked like. So again, we started from immuno and histology, and now let's see what the fetus looked grossly. So the opposite process. The cervical star would be just fresh and good looking, with no gross lesions. Often, the star will be unperforated, untouched, because the fetus is weak and doesn't do anything about it. The fetus may be still alive, because the males slip the fall very quickly, sometimes. Red is normal cervical star. That's a normal red cervical star. So where is the allantocorium? Is in touch with the cervix. And the red is normal because these villi are very rich in blood vessels. The fetus maybe is fresh generally, and it's maybe covered by fetal feces because the fetus is so stressed that start defecating in the amniotic cavity, and then fetal feces, the meconium, can be inhaled also. Also, look at the shiny coat of the fetus. Dr. Whitwell told me that she noted that this aborted fetus had this kind of shiny appearance of the coat. She speculated that this may be the surfactant that is present in the amniotic cavity at the moment of the abortion, because these fetuses start breathing in utero, so they gasp. Look at how this beautiful foal, this guy was almost ready to go, they're still present the foot pads, which indicates that this guy didn't walk much, struggled on the ground and died. You may have hyperemia of the conjunctiva plus moderate icterus because the liver disease. Often there is severe hyperemia. This is not patronymic, but it's highly suggestive. Aborted fetus generally don't show much there. These guys do, not always present. There may be abundant straw color fluid within the cavities, particularly the front thoracic cavity, pulmonary edema, due to both leakage from the blood vessels and inhalation of fluid, perineal edema, here it is, perineal edema, hyperemia of the adrenal gland. See, these are all suggestive collateral findings. Lungs can be partially inflated with rib impressions. This is not suggestive of EHV1. This could be anything in a newborn. This could be any virus, could be any bacterium. Okay, they look like this. Do histology. And then in case of inhalation of amniotic fluid, nice picture of Dr. Habecker in Bolton Center. There is this yellowish appearance, and histologically, meconium, unfortunately, is a foreign body, so there will be a non-septic, there was a non-infectious reaction, histiocytic pneumonia with this, if the animal survived. You can see the same pattern in ruminants and in ovine fetuses. Actually, the most common cases of meconium inhalation are in the ovine group. And then if you're lucky, you're going to get another pathognomonic, really pathognomonic, gross lesion or huge an abortion. On a hyperin trachea, you can see this fibrin cast. And you see it rarely. Also, you see more rarely if you don't open the trachea. So anytime you have a fetus, open the trachea. And if you got this fibrin cast, you have it. Because there is a lot of fibrin exudation in these fetuses and newborn foals. And pay attention to this cast, because it helped me to recognize another entity. Without this fibrin cast observation, probably I would have missed in 2000 one of the rare forms of EAG1 abortion or EAG1 infection. More liver, Pennsylvania 2006, New Market 93. This was New Market 93 abortion, actually was case 93/93. The most severe case of hepatic necrosis fetus I observed in my career in England. That's the British fetus, that's the American fetus. Digital photography versus Kodachromes. Of course, now you can improve and change all your old Kodachromes and clean them up from the old dust, you know, or from the beer you splash when you're putting your slides together and drinking. Rarely, the virus also likes, but in foals that already try to survive out of the mare, but for 1 or 2 days, the virus can be also detected within the a few enterocytes. That's a lucky shot. Tried several fetuses, but didn't find much. But in a foal that survived 1 or 2 days with a respiratory infection and systemic infection, there are also some virus within the crypts, mimicking another, you know, type of virus infection. Rarely you can find the virus in the kidney. The kidney is an organ that canine herpesvirus 1 loves, and equine herpesvirus could care less about it. But in this case, we found not in the tubules, but in the same cells that I show you expressing in the previous lecture, Easter-like encephalitis virus, we found using a polyclonal antibody, the virus within the nucleus and cytoplasm of these interstitial, most likely, antigen-presenting cells. But, so that's for the fetus. So we saw the respiratory infection, we saw the mild respiratory infection, we saw the viremia, we saw the abortion, so what it does, where it is, what it does. Back to the taxi driver, back to the macrophage. And where is the virus going this time? The virus is going to the CNS. And we saw everything we needed to say. We already saw that in the previous lecture of equine neuropathology. So since we are recording this, if you are listening to this presentation, make sure you also get a copy of the equine neuropathology presentation. That's for posterity, because you know that, because you just saw the lecture. And again, I already mentioned that the virus goes to the endothelium and vessel wall only. This is a vasculotropic virus. It's not a neuronotropic virus. There are manuscripts that shows the virus within the neurons, but a few are non-specific statements published. And there is one published by the British group of Newmarket where the virus goes to the rhinencephal of this pony, but this pony got, if I recall, a very heavy load of herpes virus. So endothelium, smooth muscle cells, myocytes, pericytes, lymphocytes, and macrophages here in cross-section. And as we saw previously, there is thrombosis because the endothelial damage. And then there is segmental malacia with spheroid fiber loss, myelomacrophages, as we saw in the previous presentation. And then grossly, we recognize lesions which are mainly involved in the blood vessels and the white matter. And they're non-specific, but generally when they involve blood vessels and white matter, they're going to be EAG1. They're not going to be the other equine encephalomyelitis that we discussed in the previous presentation. Grossly, the same comment applies to the, so the same comment we had for the liver lesion of the fetus. applies for the gross lesion in the adult in the CNS. They are present in a small quantity of cases. The majority are just histologic lesions. So don't base your judgment on the gross observation only. And that's new market. In 1961, several tisuno probi were born in that year. And this is the period of time. Picture is not great, but hey, it's great to have this document. This was the period of time in which people were convinced that the foal was shedding and infected the mare. Now probably the opinions are different. It was a healthy foal and a paralytic mare. But the paralytic form hits the adults. New market, 61. Peter Timoney gave me these pictures. And probably at the time, the pathologist was Brendan Farrelly, which was one Irish mentor I had when I was in Ireland for a year. And he worked as a pathologist at the Animal Health Trust in the late 50s and early 60s. Great person. Brendan Farrelly, great equine pathologist. And this is the distribution of the virus within the neural form. Brainstem also is useful. Forget the cerebellum. No, don't forget it, but not going to find much there. And then sometimes cerebrum. And then white matter will be gray matter. We have to say now that there are two types of viruses. One is mainly, that is considered mainly abortigenic, and one is considered mainly neurological. There is a segmental mutation, if I express myself well, to be detected by molecular biologists, but I heard from respectable virologists that this difference is not always, is not a clear set rule. So there may be some abortigenic strains able also to induce the myelopathy. Anyway, interesting work. Remember that you can have lesion in the urinary bladder, and this lesion could be secondary to the paralysis that this virus can induce. These horses often dribble urine. But also, in this case, I found a vasculitis, one case in my career, I found a urinary bladder vasculitis, which was associated with the virus. So this animal had the myelencephalopathy, there was virus in the spinal cord, the bladder was hemorrhagic and necrotic, probably due to the paralysis, but at the same time there was a double whammy, and there was a double hit, there was blood vessel in the bladder with antigen. I should have slid somewhere. Back to the macrophage. So we saw the abortigenic form, the myorespiratory form, and we saw the encephalomyelitis, the encephalomyelopathy, or myelencephalopathy. Back to the macrophage within the blood vessel, and we are going to see the fourth form. Pennsylvania, New Bolton Center, 1999, horse delivered for necropsy. Found dead in the morning. Found dead in the morning, I get it at 1, open up quickly, and I found histologically vascular necrosis hemorrhages, like purpura hemorrhagica. But then, since you see the gross lesion, I found something grossly that suggests me those fibrin casts in the trachea, in the bronchi of this filly. She was a 1-day-old filly. One year old filly. So virology was negative. Then PCR was even negative, professed tissue. But then, since I saw this vascular necrosis that fibrin, I tried immunohistochemistry for EHV1, and look at this. Endothelial cells sparse in the parenchyma, expressing intracytoplasmic intranuclear EHV1 antigen. At that point, I said, well, we got a virus that may be associated with something else, but induce vascular necrosis and severe lesion. In fact, look at the lung. There was severe interstitial edema, aerial hemorrhages, edema all over. And then grossly, look at this. Once I opened the chest, full of this fluid. I mean, if you open up in any country that has got African horse sickness on a research station, that's what you expect. A severe hydrothorax. And look at grossly, the whole lung was affected by this edema, and within the bronchi there was this fibrin cast. And that's what saved my day, because I saw the fibrin. And I said, fibrin, well, it's not bacteria, has to be something related to HU1. Was a good guess, lucky guess. And eventually, in 2000, I published this, and after having everybody against me, because the virologist didn't want to admit that, didn't like the idea that this was virologically negative. The molecular biologist didn't accept that this was negative for PCR. And they said that my antibody was non-specific. I said, well, this is an antibody that Professor Allen created. It's not something I did in my backyard 2 days ago. And so what I did in a pub in Philadelphia, I met a fellow scientist. Yeah, something, you know, all the stars are aligned the way you want. And she told me, well, you know, I work with a guy that pretty much created molecular biology in the United States. This gentleman now will be probably 80. It's been many years after that case. And then, so he introduced me to this guy. I said, look, I have this case. I would like to pull out this virus. I said, but I don't have fresh tissue. What do you mean you have fresh tissue? Yeah, I have stuff that I saw. So you are a pathologist, right? He said, yes. So you guys do those things in paraffin gloves, yes? Yes. That's perfect, because he's dehydrated, that's the specimen I need. So I had the molecular biologist in veterinary medicine at the time tell me that it was not possible to extract a virus from a paraffin block. And in 1999, I had these guys coming from nowhere, from a pub, that told me that was possible. And we did it. The gel was great, and then, so we identified this new form of what I call respiratory vasculotropic EHU1 infection. Three cases described. One, I found this case in the file of New Bolton Center. I was published before by Amirali Amir with a different twist. Then Anthony Blunden in Newmarket had a case similar in a zebra, also with some testicular involvement, and then this case. All with dramatic peracute lung lesion, very similar to African horse sickness. That's African horse sickness. That's EHU1. You see the difference? I don't see the difference. We are going to the end. So, how do you diagnose? How do you perform a postmortem diagnosis of 1 in 4? Histology of all the tissues, including chorioallantois, because you don't detect only EHU1, but you can have a mycotic abortion, bacterial abortion. Target tissues, lung, liver, thymus, adrenal, and spleen. Keep the placenta, because you never know, you may use it for other things. Immunohistochemic target tissues, but generally histology is confirmatory, very easy diagnosis. If it is EHV4, you may have some difficulties to find the inclusions. And then your virology will do, in addition, if you want, FA, virus isolation, and PCR target tissues. Remember, PCR, positive PCR without a pathologist has got a limited value, because it could be just a contaminated fetus with EHU1 from a stressed mare, and so you need someone that look at the lesions of this case. So that's pretty simple. You can fix the tissues quickly and have the slides 1 day or 2 days later, so you can be fast. FA is pretty much on the spot, 2 hours. And then pulmonary vasculotropic form, this one, which is velogenic, very rapid. Histology of the tissues, target tissues, lung and pharynx. Immunohistochemist target tissues, PCR target tissue. Virus isolation is difficult. Very little virus in those cases, but try them all. Microcephalopathy diagnosis, histology of all the tissues, target tissue, brainstem and spinal cord. Brainstem and also thoracolumbar. Immunohistochemistry of target tissue with lesions, PCR of target tissue with lesions, virus isolation is difficult, but combination histology PCR with the help of an immunosante will give you a diagnosis. And remember the discussion that we had before with my colleague, the dean of Thessaloniki, about what you need to do in these cases in the equine neuropathology presentation that we had before. So, do a complete necropsy. Histology is a very important tool for diagnosis of the fatal EH1 form. Combination histology, immunohistochemistry, PCR and viral solution is always useful, although histology will give you the majority of the results. Targeting a spinal cord lesion sample for better PCR results. So go to see where the lesions are, and then collect in the freezers the specimen that correspond more or less with that lesion. Remember that there is abortion virological negative fetuses following experimental challenge, as been described by Professor Smith at the time and collaborators. Detection of EH1 the fetal members of aborted equine fetus by immunohistochemical and cytopenetration technique. So there are some cases where the virus is present in significant quantities in the placenta, and this is a manuscript of Dr. Zeredi of Budapest, good pathologist. One of our colleagues worked a lot on equines as well. And EH1 and other equine viruses are here to stay in to cause disease because vaccination covers for the genital form somehow, but doesn't cover at all for the myoencephalopathy. And this is the case I just mentioned during the equine neuropathology lecture. Remember that you can have a neurologic cord shedding EH1. That is not necessarily a case of EH1 myoencephalopathy. Racetrack stress horse was shedding EH1, detected via PCR, but we detected via necropsy that was sarcocystis neurona. So consider also the possible and the impossible in these cases. And that's for EHV forms. And again, thank you for your time and consideration. Any question? Yes, sir.
You had in the slide where you detect the virus in the interstitial cells of the kidney.
Yeah, one case in a equine fetus.
Okay.
I should remove it because it would give people the wrong perspective because the virus doesn't look that parenchyma very much.
Is there an explanation about this? Because we found the same that you can explain with enterocolitis virus. And we detect also this virus in some interstitial cells.
This goes back to what I said during my equine neuropathology presentation, where I showed that Easter equine encephalitis alpha virus goes to the interstitium of the kidney. And I mentioned that the interstitium of the kidney has got at least three cell types. One is fibroblast, one is antigen-presenting cells, and one are probably some smooth muscle cells. So three types at least, and I think the virus goes in the antigen-presenting cells. It's picked up. And we can see virus in the interstitium. So you mentioned encephalomyocarditis virus, right? What did you mention? Yeah, so it's a picornavirus, similar to aftovirus. It's a cardiovirus. Cardiovirus, aftovirus. PERS go to the interstitium of the kidney. So porcinatory virus go in pigs in the interstitium, probably the same cells. Equine baratoritis goes to the tubular cells of the kidney, but also a little bit in the interstitium occasionally. So another artery virus, nidovirus that goes there. And now occasionally EH1. So it's the interstitium of the kidney is a station for some viral infections. I'm sure I'm missing some interstitial detection of viral infection that I observed in my career. But these are the viruses that generally I remember detecting there. And I'm glad you mentioned this encephalomyocarditis virus because the interstitium could be a transient site of infection in certain cases. Generally, there is not much virus there, but you know, a moderate expression is present in these diseases. Yeah, of course. There is a disadvantage. I don't want to sound naive in my interpretation. There is some disadvantage to be there because it's interstitium. It would be more effective to be in the tubule, so the virus, like in equine baratoritis or infectious in horses or infectious bronchitis in chickens, the nephropathic form where the virus multiply in the renal epithelium can be shed into the environment. And we'll see that in equine varicoarthritis in the next presentation, which is going to be about all the other viral diseases of horses. So good comment. This was the Dean of University of Thessaloniki that asked very good questions during this meeting. Yes, sir.
If you may explain once again, how much relevant is if the animals are vaccinated?
So the question is about vaccination, and you ask about also about the infection rate in vaccinated and non-vaccinated animal.
Right. Or if it's possible that they get disease.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm not. This is a question for the wrong faculty, because there are some people in Newmarket, in Kentucky, and there is the Dean of North Carolina, Dr. Paul Loon, that would be the right people to ask these questions, since they're equine immunologists. But I can tell you that in the past, in Europe, in the 60s and 70s, in non-vaccinated farms, there were abortion storms. So 100 pregnant mares, the majority abort, it's called abortion storms. When then vaccination started, and then mares got vaccinated 3 to 5 times before parturition, plus at the same time, hygienic and biosecurity measures started to be enforced, like handling the horses, you know, not when you go from mare to mare, try to be careful. Same thing that happened in Vienna in the 1800 with the puerperal fever, where you know, they noted that the MD, the doctor, were the carrier of the infection. You know? So biosecurity measures. Now we see sporadic abortions, but we still see small outbreaks. I remember a few when I was in Pennsylvania. I mean, remember every 2 or 3 years there was something hot. Probably also depending on the virus type. Because the last one I saw, the virus was present in other tissue than the one I described. It was even pancreatic necrosis once in my life. So it's probably also a type of virus involved. At the moment, there is an increased cases of myelencephalopathy because, first of all, we got better in diagnosing it. And they sent cases to the pathologist and to the virologist. Second, the vaccination still doesn't work against the myelencephalopathy. There is no vaccine that works, unfortunately. And then we see less abortions in well-managed areas, which means England, Ireland, Kentucky, some other area of the United States. I assume in other parts of the world where these biosecurity measures and vaccination protocols are less respected. I saw a few also in Europe. I don't mention the others, but I saw quite a few sad cases in my recent and past career. Well, in these places, there is still probably the same. They can see the same episodes that were seen in Europe, United States in the 60s and the 70s. So vaccination exists, protects somehow against the abortogenic form. It doesn't protect for the myelencephalopathy. Anybody will tell you something different? Well, show me the data, yes. Did I answer your question?
Yes.
Okay. Would you like to stretch 5 minutes before we go to the second presentation about viral diseases? Or we just start as we are?
Break,
okay, 5 minutes. I mean five, which means stretching, restroom, and then back here.